Hello, friends, and welcome to another episode of The Biscuit. I'm your host, William Bartram. Before we get into today's episode, I would just like to let you guys know about the Mustache Classic. The Biscuit Podcast is a proud supporter of the Mustache Classic ice hockey outing for men's cancer and suicide prevention benefiting Movember on November 21st, 2020 at Danbury Arena, presented by Champion Elevator and ProStockHockey.com. Start having important conversations because suicide notes talk too late. That is a great organization. They got, I don't know if charity is the correct word for it, but make sure to go follow them on all the social media and all that. Let them know and talk to your buddies. And just, you know, if you're having any issues, find some help. It's never too late. The Biscuit is also brought to you by Hairless Ape Conspiracies. What does it mean to be a hairless ape? It's more than just a t-shirt with a catchphrase. It's a way of looking at a world, a way of seeing failure as an opportunity to improve past our one-time best, seeing hardship and tragedy as lessons taught in pain, sweat, and blood, viewing our small community as our tribe, and our tribalism as something to be professed and propagated, a way of seeing mortal life as a challenge to be bested, to be competed against, holding nothing back. Seeing our inner and outer strengths as our faith and depending on ourselves and our skills to be the things we count on in challenges of life seem to be winning. Our unique perspective is that we need to get back to the natural order of things, strengthening our bodies with hard work, strengthening our minds by seeking and gaining knowledge wherever we find it, and attacking our passions and our lives with these true strengths. Knowing we only live each day, we are present in the moment and we find ways to make the most of every day. We fight hard, we love harder, and we don't stop until they throw dirt upon us. Mission statement over at Hairless Ape Conspiracies is to increase our influence, spread our dogma, and create a brand that is as true to our patrons as they are to their passions. And if you guys want to go find some gear over at hairlessapeinc.com, use the promo code BISCUIT10 at checkout. Save yourself 10% off. As always, we are brought to you by parkersplatoon.org. If you guys have been on the internet, you see that Scott Parker had Darren McCarty over, and they were, you know, doing some things for the charity, working on some things. Exciting, exciting stuff over there, the Parkers and their nonprofit organization to help one veteran at a time. And as of now, we're still brought to you by hockeyfights.com. I have a meeting with them soon. I don't know if it's good or bad. I couldn't quite tell. So, you know, if you guys like that I'm still partnered up with Hockey Fights, let me know, let them know. And we'll see what happens. They said, I had just reached out to them after taking a little bit of break and was explaining what's going on. And they said this is a perfect time to get a hold of them. Let's chat soon. So I'm supposed to be talking, have a meeting here in the next couple days. So I'll keep you guys informed with that. Until then, go to hockeyfights.com. That's hockeyfights.com, where you go to watch hockey fights. Today's episode is Steve Byrne. Enjoy.
Now Probert got the right hand free.
He's loose with the right hand, and he starts to retaliate. And down goes Nyland, and the two of them are hammering each other.
Knights of Columbus, that hurt.
It's old time hockey.
Enforcer of all hockey podcasts. It's The Biscuit. It's The Biscuit.
Damn it! Their school regulation size of one!
The enforcer of all hockey podcasts.
God help the fucking day if fighting's ever banned. As a country will stop working on some badness fucking can.
Hi, everybody. It's The Biscuit Podcast.
Hey, wanna go? Yeah, okay. Good luck, man.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, I am joined to you today with the writer and director of maybe one of the best sitcoms ever, Sullivan and Son. the great documentary, Always Amazing. He is a Golden Flash. He is the front man of Sausage Party and a Penguin superfan. The one, the only Steve Byrne. How's it going, man?
Good. Good to talk to you. It's nice to talk to somebody that knows a little bit about hockey. I'd say a lot about hockey, actually.
Well, do you find that annoying in your life?
Yeah, I'm one of the few that lives in America that loves when I go to Canada, because in America, when you turn on SportsCenter, it's all football and no hockey. And when I go to Canada, it's all hockey and rarely any football. So I'm in heaven when I'm in Canada. I love it.
Well, that's like my younger brother and I are big hockey fans. And then my older brother and the entire rest of my family could give a fuck less. So it's like we're like speaking a different language when we're over at the house, you know?
Yeah.
And it's so strange too, but it's like, you know, I don't get it. Like if you've seen it and then there's still people who don't like it, that's what blows my mind. And have you ever met someone like that where they still don't get it and you're just like, what are you watching something different than I am?
Yeah, look, it's tomato, tomato. You know, some people hate Frank Sinatra. Some people don't like the Beatles. I don't understand it, but there are those people. I personally think hockey is the greatest sport on the face of the planet. I love it.
Well, I agree. And it's awesome, you know, when you're on podcasts because you'll bring it up quite a bit. And I think it's just as big for the game as anyone else bringing it up. You know, you're a big profile and you mentioning it or saying that you like the game, I think it helps spread the word on hockey too. So I appreciate you spreading the word on it. You know, it's like every other normal Irish Korean kid, just a big hockey guy, right?
Oh, that's right. There's so many of us, you know. It's
well, plethora. How did your love for the game start?
I fell in love with hockey. My father grew up playing like roller hockey in New York City, and then he started playing adult league when I was a kid. And when I was 5, he would take me to the ice rink, and I would hang onto his jersey, and he'd skate around the rink, and I just hold on for dear life. And when I was 6, I started playing. And my first year, I was horrible. And my second year, for some reason, it started to click. I was able to skate a bit more. It was like night and day from my first year to my second year. So right after that, I was pretty hooked. And I moved to Pittsburgh when I was 9 or 10. And Mario Lemieux was in Pittsburgh. And I was absolutely enamored, as anybody else would be, you know?
Yeah, he would kind of do it, right? I mean, he brought not even just, you know, the game to the States, but I mean, Pittsburgh in particular is, you know, he's like a god there.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, you know, you think about Pittsburgh, it's synonymous with the Steel Curtain and Pittsburgh Steelers.
Yeah.
The Pirates, not so much. And to know that Lemieux came in and made the Penguins the talk of the town, and then Crosby comes in during the Roethlisberger era and made it the Crosby era. Pittsburgh's definitely a huge hockey market, and that was not always the case. And the old adage is, you know, the Civic Arena or PNC would have definitely, or PPG would have been a parking lot if not for Mario and Sid together keeping that team in town.
Now, how do you feel about the future of the team with guys like Sidney and Evgeny being on the wrong side of their career? And then, you know, a guy like Matt Murray, who was supposed to be the future, you know, getting traded or signing somewhere else.
Yeah, it's heartbreaking now looking at the fact that you see people in the press trying to, you know, find ways with the cap to get Fleury back. I think we should have kept Murray or Fleury. I was always a big fan of his. And I think he's a great locker room presence. He seemed to keep things light on the ice for the team because Sid seems to be not as serious as Captain Serious over there in Chicago. But was a good presence in the locker room. And he took the Golden Knights to the Stanley Cup. I mean, what more can he ask for a goalie? And he became the face of the franchise. So, look, I think we should have kept Fleury. Hindsight's always 20/20. I do think that the window has closed for the Penguins, unfortunately.
Yeah.
I think they'll be competitive. I love Sid. I love Malkin. I'll watch. You never know. But I think that they're not who they were even 3 to 4 years ago.
Well, we had, you know, my former co-host, we had a heated debate when it happened because I was on the side you're with, the camp, you know, of keeping Fleury and not being able to trust the kid who, you know, came in and had a great playoffs. But I was like, how do you get rid of Fleury, man? He's such a good Pittsburgh guy. And, you know, how comfortable Sidney was with him on the ice, too, is you can't understate that. I wouldn't be surprised if they can sneak one more out, but it'll be surprising if it happens, if that makes sense. It's not, you know what I mean?
Yeah, you look at the Kings, you look at the Hawks, and you look at the Pens, and there's a good sample size between all of them. And at some point, everybody just kind of dipped. So, you know, it is what it is.
I still think that Sidney Crosby is the greatest player in the NHL, though. I don't think he's turned just yet. I think Connor is right on his heels, but I still think Sidney is the best player in the league.
There's no doubt the NHL is in great hands. The future with Connor McDavid, Austin Matthews, Jack Eichel, and knowing that Taylor Hall is now going to the Sabres, it's like, I hope they finally put the team together in Buffalo, because that fan base deserves a great team to root for. You could say the same thing about Toronto, right?
Yeah.
But look, I really, really think that Crosby, it's what's amazing to me is that I grew up in a great era of hockey, watching, you know, enforcers, Detroit and Colorado going at it, and Lemieux and Yzerman and Gretzky. And now we have this great moment in time where the two best players when I was growing up were Wayne Gretzky playing on the Oilers and Mario Lemieux playing on the Pittsburgh Penguins. And now we live in a day and age where Connor McDavid plays for the Oilers and Sidney Crosby plays for the Pittsburgh Penguins. And the one thing I never got to see was 1993 was the closest the Penguins ever got to playing Gretzky in the finals. If they just got past the Islanders, I think you would have had a Lemieux-Gretzky matchup. And I'm praying to God before I die, hopefully by the hockey gods anointing us a miracle, we could see Connor McDavid and Sidney Crosby, you know, together in the Stanley Cup Finals. That would be great.
The NHL would shit their pants if those two met the Cup. Could you imagine the marketing monster behind that?
Oh my God,
dude, it'd be fun.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now
I would love it, but unfortunately, that's the good thing about hockey. Is that with the NBA, you're always going to see LeBron there, right?
Mm-hmm.
And with hockey, it's a crapshoot. Anything can happen at any given time. Who would have thought that the Vegas Golden Knights would have gotten the Stanley Cup Finals their first year? But that's the great – that's what differentiates hockey from all the other sports, is that anything can happen come – well, normally you would say, you know, April or May. But now we're, I guess, in October. So who knows, you know? Who knows?
Well, yeah, how weird is that? We would be into the season right now, but, you know, like a handful of games at this point.
Yeah, we got to wait till January. And hopefully that's you know, who knows what will happen. But maybe it's a good thing for teams like the Penguins, teams like the Blackhawks, to give these older legs a bit more rest. And who knows? Maybe it'll help Kane and Taze make another one last run. Or maybe it'll help Crosby, Malkin, and Letang make one last run. You know, it's crazy days, but that's the great thing about the sport.
Yeah, and guys like Chara have to be going, oh, thank God I don't have to go till January.
Exactly, yeah.
You know, that's right. He's 95 this year, so it's like, oh, I get at least a little bit of a break before the season starts.
Yeah, absolutely. Look, hockey fans are always going to be hockey fans. I'm hoping that the pandemic helped. I was one of the few that I don't like Gary Bettman. I think he's done some horrible things, but he pulled it off. No COVID cases. We got a Stanley Cup winner. I think he overdid it at times with Stadium Series and all that stuff. But yeah. He's done some good things. You know, we didn't get any virtual booing out of EA Sports when they did it. But it was really good to see. I was happy that he pulled it off.
Now, as a comedian, do you think they dropped the ball there? Where they should have just gave out, you know, maybe just as a little joke to send in a fake boo.
I would have appreciated it. I think Gary Bettman seems to have a sense of humor about it, too.
Oh, yeah. I think he kind of digs at this point. He plays the heel a little bit. And he knows that, you know, a lot of people don't like him for a lot of reasons. But this was one time where it was like, holy shit, is Bettman the best commissioner in sports? Like, he did it. He nailed it.
Him and Dana White, I think they both pulled it off.
Oh, yeah, man. What Dana's doing is incredible. Now, you started playing, you said, when you were 5. Do you still get on the ice any, you know, today?
Yeah, I still get out there every now and then. It's probably been a year and a half to 2 years since I played, unfortunately. I had some downtime, and I sold my house in California, staying with my folks in Florida until my house is done in Tennessee. And I unfortunately packed my bags up because my father plays. He skates at least 6 times a week in Tampa, Florida with a great bunch of guys. And I was going to skate with them. He's 72. He's unbelievable. He refs hockey games and plays all the time. And I'm just bummed I didn't bring my equipment. But I used to run a night with Bill Burr, Tuesday nights in Burbank, all the comics in L.A. that played hockey and were comedians. We got a great bunch of guys out together once a week to skate. We did that for quite some time. And then we all got just too busy. Bill Burr had to become a superstar. Yeah. I had to do a movie, so it kind of fell by the wayside. But hopefully we'll get it back together.
Now, I've heard lore of this league. What other comedians were in the – because any guy that was out west would talk about this comedians league, and it seemed like a pretty good time.
It was a great time. Ian Bagg, a great comic from Canada, really popular here in the States. He was on it. He would shit talk all the time. J.P. Buck, for example, who books all the comics on Conan O'Brien, he was there. It was a great bunch of guys. And every now and then we have some great comics float in and out of it. One night we almost had Hayden Christensen come by who played Darth Vader, because one of our buddies grew up playing hockey with him, and he was in town, and he almost came down to skate. So I was so pissed one night I could have played with Darth Vader.
Now that's like on my tombstone, I played hockey with Darth Vader.
Yeah, exactly.
Did Alan Thicke or anybody, like old actors, come through? You know, I always heard he had a hell of a game before he unfortunately passed.
I did hear that about him. No, we kind of kept it close in our community, because then all of a sudden you got Jerry Bruckheimer's all-star Hollywood scene, you know, and we just kept it a bunch of ragtag comics playing together.
Now, how did that start? Was it just you guys all played growing up? So it was like, hey, we're all out here. We can get some ice together. Let's go play.
Yeah, I was just jonesing to get back on the ice, and I just called up. I know Burr has equipment. And called up all the guys I know that have skated in the past, and we've talked about hockey, and just got a good core together. And one of my buddies, this kid Danny, he knew all the goalies in town, so we always had goalies, which was a lot of fun. It was just a great time. It was a great skate.
And that's always the hardest part is getting. That's always the hardest part is getting goaltenders. There's the guy who's going to play, you know, three games in a row at night.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. We always got lucky. I think they just wanted to play with some comics, which was nice.
Now, your dad being such a big hockey fan, did you get to go to a bunch of games as a kid?
I went to a bunch of Devils games when I was a kid, and I always thought it was cool because my last name's Byrne. We went to the Brendan Byrne Arena, and the Devils were new to the scene. And then when I was in Pittsburgh, when I was in junior high school and high school, my friends and I used to go down to the Civic Arena and we would buy scalp tickets for like 15 or 20 bucks. And looking back on that, it's like, man, I got to see Mario Lemieux for 15 or 20 bucks. And the great thing about the Penguins back in the day was that no matter what the score was, with 2 minutes left, they always had a chance to win. And I remember so many games where they came back in the third period with, you know, a minute or two left in the game. And Lemieux and Yager, you know, you just get them on the ice and you watch magic happen. And then you had Ron Francis. You think of all those great, you know, all those great players that played for them. Mark Recchi, I got to play in the fantasy league that Lemieux had. And Bill Burr and I did a show for them, and then we got to skate with them for the weekend. And I'll never forget receiving a pass from Mario Lemieux. I caught the pass, and I was like, I want to lay down on the ice and just soak in this moment, because I just caught a pass from Lemieux. It was great. And then Mark Recchi drilled me into the boards, and I heard him laughing as he skated away. And we still keep in touch to this day, but that was really cool. Phil Bork and I have got to know each other quite a bit. When the Pens were playing the Capitals, I was in D.C. at the Improv, and he and a bunch of the, you know, the commentators came by, and we got some drinks that night. It was so cool just talking to Borky about his day back in the day playing for the Pens, and he's got a great book out there right now that he wrote an autobiography, and it's just a great read.
I'll have to pick that up. Now I got to back up a second. You said you got to skate in a game with Mario Lemieux.
Yeah, the fantasy camp. I got to skate with Lemieux. Mark Recchi, Ty Domi, Larry Murphy, Randy Hillier was my coach, Bob Johnson was our coach. So, or not Bob Johnson. I'm getting all my names confused here. But it's just a ton of great talent out there.
Wow.
And we all got to skate with these guys that were, you know, legends that I grew up with. It was absolutely unbelievable, and a memory I will cherish the rest of my life.
Oh, absolutely. So, you know, they always talk about watching Mario, you know, skate. Was it even more impressive, like, on the ice with him, or was it just you're just in awe because you're out there in fantasy camp? You know, were you able to even drink it in at the moment?
Yeah, I definitely was. And the great thing about Mario is that he's so accessible, and I talked to some of the campers, and they said, you know, we had gone, some of us had gone to Gretzky's like fantasy camp, and he never hung out. He just kind of, the only time you see him is on the ice, but he never really socialized with anybody. I'm not trying to make him seem like he's a bad person or anything, but he was just there and it was all about business. And Mario, you know, all the campers stayed at the same hotel that was right next to the arena at PPG Paints Arena. And we would finish the games and then we'd go to the bar and hang out. And Mario would come and hang out with everybody. And the one night I remember he said, you know, I'm putting my card down. Everybody's drinking on me tonight. And it was like Mario Lemieux just bought me a beer. Granted, I was with, you know, like 75 other guys, but it was like, it was really cool. And then Bill Byrne and I sat down at the table with him and Ty Domi and a bunch of other ex all-stars that were all swapping war stories, either us from the road or these guys from the road. And just what a first-class guy. I've always heard that about him. But in the few times I've gotten to hang out with him, it's just been nothing short of an amazing experience.
And that's probably a rare moment where, you know, you being a comedian, Bill Burr, too, like where you guys are not holding court with the guys. You're sitting there all years, you know, instead of running the table. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it was nice to be upstaged for once and not have people fascinated with our war stories. You know, I'll never forget the time. Oasis is a huge, you know, a band that I've grown up with and I love to this day. And I met Liam and Noel Gallagher, and Liam ended up asking me 10 minutes straight about what it's like to be a stand-up comic and how he's wanted to be a stand-up comic. And I was just like, you're somebody I've read every magazine article about. I got 1,000 questions for you. And it was amazing that he wanted to know about me and stand-up. I thought that was really wild. But you go and you sit down with a bunch of hockey players and you have a few beers and all of a sudden the inhibitions let loose and the stories fly. And it was one of the greatest nights of my life.
That's absolutely incredible, man. And you've been able to turn, you know, these road stories into, you know, a passion project of yours. I know you have a new film coming out, Opening Act, where you've kind of incorporated, it's not necessarily a biography, but you've definitely pulled a lot of things from your life and put it into the film, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, it's definitely semi-autobiographical. Once the character Will Chu hits the road, everything in the film has happened to me in real life. So you're going to watch this and go, there's no way that fucking happened. And I'm going to tell you, I did end up in the woods underneath the trailer, fearing for my life while a couple above me had sex. Yes, it really did happen. Everything in the film happened. And that's the great thing about the film is that the film is really about a comic's time in his life where he quits the safe day job and goes all in on stand-up comedy. And you're following this young kid out for the first time ever at a professional stand-up comedy club. So it's all the trial by fire episodes of bachelorette parties, hecklers, doing morning radio for the first time, and pleasing the manager. All the little things you kind of take for granted that the audience doesn't necessarily know. So I would say this to everybody. You've been to a comedy club. You've never been on the road until now with this movie. This is the best film about stand-up comedy. I swear to God it is. Watch it. It's the opening act. It's fucking great.
I'm excited, man. And it comes out, what, this Friday the 16th?
Comes out the Friday the 16th. It's got a crazy cast. Jimmy O. Yang plays the MC from Silicon Valley. Alex Moffat from SNL plays the feature act. Cedric the Entertainer plays the headliner. Then it's Whitney Cummings, Eliza Schlesinger, Angela Johnson, Kathleen Madigan, Bill Burr, Ken Jeong, Tom Segura, Neil Brennan, Roy Wood Jr., Russell Peters, Canada's own, all in this film. And it's really the badge of honor I have is that all the comics that have seen it, that have screened it, have all called or texted me and they say the same three things. I loved it. It was so authentic. And you re-triggered all these awful memories that now I have to go see my therapist again. You son of a bitch. So I really wear that as a badge of honor.
Well, I was going to ask, you know, I toured in a death metal band for 10 years. And, you know, I look back on those times now where, you know, you're sleeping under a picnic table at a rest area or, you know, staying in people's houses that you don't know. And it's fun to look back on that anxiety-ridden time now. Are you able to look back on that, you know, on your stories and be like, oh, thank God I'm successful, you know, like I made it through that? Because shit can get wild when you do take that plunge, like you said, and you're all in.
Yeah, I mean, that's really what the film celebrates, exactly what you're talking about. It's that blind optimism, the romanticism of better days, but knowing I got to suffer through this bullshit right now to get to where I ultimately want to be. And it's all those hurdles that Jimmy's character goes through that really makes the ride a lot more fun. Look, he fails every bit of the way, but that's the humor in it. And I think that's what people are going to really be exposed to is the consistent basis that failure is providing stand-up comedians, especially at the beginning of their careers, because they've never experienced morning radio. They don't know how to do it. They don't know how to deal with hecklers. They don't know how to deal with a bachelorette party. So it's all those things, again, trial by fire, that you've just got to endure, and all those things will make you a better comic.
Now, the film, is it going to theaters that are open? Is it all on demand? How are people able to get their hands on it?
Yeah, so you could see it in select movie theaters. I guess you would have to fly to Texas, a red state here in the United States, to see that. But in reality, it's going to be streaming VOD, Amazon, iTunes, wherever you stream films, and you can rent or purchase it Friday the 16th.
Hell yeah, man. I'll definitely be doing that. I'm very excited. What would be like one of the most memorable games that you think like you can look back on and go like, oh, holy shit, I saw Mario get a hat trick, or, you know, Ty Domi got in a fight against, you know, McSorley at a game?
Oh, geez, that's a great question. You know, they're kind of cobbled together for me as part of my childhood. But the last Penguin game I really went to that I thoroughly enjoyed, I've been to some playoff games that have taken place at PPG Paints Arena, the new one. But I got to see one of the last games at the Igloo, the old home of the Penguins, when the Penguins traded for Marian Hossa. And the Penguins went to the finals that year and lost to Detroit. And they wore the powder blue jerseys, and they played the Rangers and beat the Rangers. And I believe Jágr was on that team at the time. So it was really, really kind of sweet to see that. If I'm not wrong, I believe that's the case. But it was great when Marian Hossa played with us, and then he went to the Wings the next year, and then we played the Wings, and then Marian Hossa lost that series. And then he went to the Blackhawks and obviously got his cup. But he went 0-2 in the finals, which you think if you just stayed with one of the teams, you would have won. But it is what it is, right?
That's right, man. Now, I'm an Ohio guy, so, you know, I'm interested to hear about your time at Kent State, how you even ended up going to Kent State.
Well, you're going to love this film then, because the character that Jimmy plays is from Steubenville, Ohio.
Hell yeah.
And he goes to Pennsylvania, and there's a great running joke about Ohio sucks.
Oh, come on, man.
Yeah, well, look, I went to Kent State University, and I love Ohio, and Jimmy makes light of the incident. You'll see why it happens. It doesn't just happen to be mean. There's a reason behind it. But I went to Kent State because I went to, obviously, high school in Pittsburgh, and I applied to a bunch of schools in Pennsylvania. I didn't get in any of them. Kent State accepted me. I never saw the campus until my first day of classes, so that's how keen I was on my education. But I love Ohio. I love the fact that I went to Kent State, and I have friends to this day from my time at Kent State. And the old adage is, can't read, can't write Kent State. But I got out of there, and I think I did well for myself. So I'm proud of the fact that I went there.
I have been to a Bigfoot convention in Steubenville, Ohio.
Dude, that's awesome, man.
The mutants you see at that place, buddy, I tell you, it's like the best human-watching place you could ever go is a Bigfoot convention in Ohio.
That's crazy. Well, I love Steubenville because it's home to Dean Martin, and that was my nod to saying, you know, how much I love Dean Martin.
So are you a big crooner guy?
I love standards. I love Tony Bennett. I've seen him once or twice. I've seen Michael Bublé once or twice. I've gotten to meet Harry Connick Jr. quite a few times. I'm friends with his bass player, Neil Kane, who actually did music for the film. I'm a big standards guy, but my favorite is alt music. When I was growing up, everybody loved hip hop. I just could never get on board. So I love The Killers. I love Oasis, Britpop, The Verve, all that stuff, Radiohead.
Well, you've kind of got that. I mean, you don't go on stage without a suit and tie, right? I mean, you've got that classic feel to your stand-up as well. It's kind of nice to see. And it throws you for a loop, though, because you see you in a suit, and then you hear you, and you go, oh, shit. Like, your brain kind of – it plays a trick on you almost.
Yeah, I get a little dirty, so the suit kind of cleans up the act. But but I always got dressed up in a suit because I saw Don Rickles do it, and I thought, man, he looks timeless, even at his old age. And I want to be timeless. I want to wear a suit on stage. And it's also a form of respect to the audience to say, you got a babysitter. You took your girl out for a night out on the town. I'm going to make sure you have a great time tonight. And that's really what it's about for me.
Well, it's very professional. I mean, it really – it's better than seeing, like, you know, someone just roll up there in, like, a sweatpants and, like, a t-shirt. There is a difference.
Yeah, there's a lot of comics that do that. I mean, Bert Kreischer doesn't wear a shirt at all, so I like to try to class it up as much as I can.
Now, Steve, I'm glad we could get together and do this, man. I have to tell the story of I don't know when it was, but we had tried to get this together at least a year ago. I think it was like when Phil Kessel got traded to Arizona. But the crazy story is my power went out here, and I drove to Walmart to use their Wi-Fi just to send you an email to saying like, hey, man, I'm so sorry. And I appreciate you being cool and taking time out of your busy, you know, schedule to come back on and actually work that out for me, man. I appreciate it.
Yeah, look, I appreciate you having me on. I'm sorry it took me so long to get back to you. I apologize. It has been hectic. I mean, today I was, you know, I'm here in LA, so everything starts 3 hours later. So I was on my phone from 5 a.m. until 3 this afternoon. So it's been nonstop promoting this film. But anytime I get to talk hockey, it's really nice because the whole day I've been talking about the film. So it's nice to take a break from it and just talk about my real passion in life, which is watching NHL, you know.
Now, we're presented by Hockey Fights, and you had mentioned earlier that, you know, you grew up watching guys fight. Are you still a Hockey Fight fan?
Fuck yeah.
Fuck yeah. That,
absolutely.
You're my man.
I love it. I think it is a part of the game. I think it was a way for the players, again, to police themselves. You know, you didn't have to wait for the refs to do it. And unfortunately, in this day and age of political correctness and cancel culture, we're ultra sensitive. You have people that probably aren't even hockey fans asking for the fighting to be taken out. But the true passionate fans, I believe, will always be there and always appreciate a good scrap.
Yeah, I argue to the teeth that, you know, with anybody that it's not a part of the game. It absolutely is. And I think it has to remain in there, and I hope it does. And it's still working because look at Tampa Bay this year. They added tough guys to their team, and they ended up winning the cup finally. And, you know, look at Toronto. They're trying to do the same thing, getting Bogosian and, you know, Wayne Simmonds on there. You know, it's all fine and dandy in the regular season to score your 5 goals, have the pretty kids on the team, and, you know, have the PlayStation looking goals, but come crunch time, you know, it's big boy hockey and, you know, big boys fight sometimes.
That's right. That's why one of my favorite players, I mean, he was only with us for a few months, but Ryan Reeves, he goes to Vegas and then he does get to go on a cup run, which has been nice. I think he's one of those dynamic players. He's got a lot of heart, seems like a good locker room guy, but also he's going to stick up for his teammates. And I think that's one of the mistakes the Penguins have made over these years is not having somebody to protect Crosby. Because the league has taken liberties with the guy.
Yeah, they'll get like a guy in for like a few months. Like they'll have LaRocque for a little bit or Reeves for a little bit. And I don't know what ends up happening, but they never keep them for too long.
Yeah, it's a shame. It's a real shame because there is talent on those fourth lines as well. You know, I mean, anybody that makes it the NHL is gifted. But yeah, it's good to see a guy like Ryan Reeves succeed.
Did you enjoy bubble hockey this year? Did you get into it?
I did. I mean, just being away from sports in general was tough. But then this was the first year I really kind of like got into, you know, all those out of market games. And I just followed everything because I was just so passionate to follow hockey. It was a shame to see the Pens get bounced that quickly by the Habs. But yeah, at the same time, I got to watch a lot of great hockey. And I really love watching the Golden Knights. I think they're just such a fast, fun team to watch.
They're growing on me, man. I was a little salty they went to the cup that first year just because I'm a Blue Jackets fan. It's like, you know, when's going to be my time? But I like the white gloves. I like the city of Las Vegas. I like the idea of being able to go out there and go to a hockey game while I can go to the strip after that. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's fun. And it's great to see how passionate the city has been about them. You know, I played Vegas quite a bit and, you know, when they're playing, you see them on the TVs everywhere. You see people, you know, some of the blackjack dealers wearing their jerseys. It's nice to see the city adopt them so well because Vegas is a passionate fan base. They just haven't had anything to root for.
Yeah, absolutely. And they'll keep growing that fan base and they keep staying successful. You know, adding Petrangelo doesn't hurt either. So you're leaving, you know, California. You're going to Tennessee. So are you going to become a Predators fan now, man? Are you going to leave the base?
I'll go to the games, but I'm still a diehard Pens fan. You know, when I lived in Chicago, I got to know some of the Blackhawks. I went to a lot of the games, and those guys were super nice to me. Dave Bolin and I are still great pals to this day. But yeah, I will say that I'll go to some Preds games for sure. I'll support hockey. I've been to games all over. I've been to Flyers games, and I hate the Flyers, but any chance to see hockey live, I'll take it.
Absolutely. I agree. I go with my wife to go see the Wings because I married a woman from Michigan. So it's
you're a good man.
It's yeah. And it's fucking awesome to go to the arena with Wings fans. They're animals. It's a blast.
That's right. Yeah. It's hockey town, baby.
Fuck yeah. It's fun. I got to see the Joe. You know, it was cool, man. Well, I wish you the best of luck with everything, man. I can't wait to see this movie. Again, I appreciate you fitting in the time. I know you've got press this whole week, and I know how crazy that can be. So just again, let the listeners know where they can find you and how they can get their hands on the film.
Yeah, so Amazon, iTunes, if you by chance happen to live by a movie theater that's showing movies, you can watch it. There are select theaters that are showing it. But iTunes and Amazon, that's where you can see it, wherever you stream films. And I promise you, you will have a great time. We could all use a laugh these days. There have been so few comedies that have come out during this pandemic, and this is one of the better ones. If you love stand-up, you're going to see some of your favorite comics in this.
I'm very excited, man. And if you guys are listening and you haven't seen his documentary, Always Amazing, you have to go do that. It'll blow your mind. It is a masterpiece.
Yeah, well, thank you so much. It's available on YouTube. Just type in Always Amazing. It's completely free.
So give me a prediction before you go. Penguins, 2020-21, how do they do? Playoffs, wild card, miss it? What do you think?
I think they'll keep the playoff streak alive, but I don't know that they're going to get past the second round. The only thing I'll say is this rest may help them because technically they've been resting for probably 6 months, and they've made so many deep runs in the past. And I think the wear and tear, just the regular season, this whole pandemic has kind of recalibrated a lot of teams, I think, in terms of their rest. So I'm hoping that they get some fresh legs that can sustain over the course of a shortened season. We'll see what happens.
I think that's a safe bet, man. That sounds good to me.
Yeah. All right. Well, thanks for having me. I appreciate it. Good luck to your Blue Jackets.
Hey, stay safe out there, bud.
All right. Be well.
Bye. Later. How many bucks do I give?